Welcome to the campus of North Idaho College and today's broadcast of the North Idaho College Public Forum. The crew is comprised of North Idaho College television students. Your moderator is North Idaho College political scientist, Tony Stewart.
Today we wish to discuss with you a topic that has not been heard very much about in this area up until this time, but I assure you in the months and years ahead it will be. We're going to discuss today the superconducting supercollider, and you may ask, what on earth is that? Well, we'll find out with our guests on the program today. This is a major project that's going to be undertaken in this country, and it's my understanding that the decision will be made by 1990. This is going to come from the federal government and the Department of Energy. Idaho is going to be one of those places in the United States, or one of the states, that's going to work very hard to get this project, and we're talking a project that can amount to somewhere between $4 and $7 billion. We are happy to welcome to our program today a man that will be working in Idaho to make sure that we're successful. Our guest is Rick Trimbley. He is the coordinator of this SSC program, which is located in the Department of Commerce for the state of Idaho. Rick, it's a pleasure to have you with us today.
Thank you.
I also want to thank Sandy Emerson and the Coeur d'Alene Chamber of Commerce for their cooperation in making this program possible. And our panel today to question our guests on this very important topic for the economic and research future of some place in the United States, I would like to invite to the panel, first of all, Steve Schenck, who is the Director of Informational Services at North Idaho College. And I'm happy, as I have had before, Sandy Emerson with us as the Vice President Executive Director of the Coeur d'Alene Chamber of Commerce. And I shall invite Steve Schenck to commence the questioning.
Thank you, Tony. Mr. Trimbley, what in the world is it is maybe the best place to start. What exactly is a superconducting supercollider?
Okay, the superconducting supercollider, if you will, is a kind of microscope. A kind of microscope that is essential to scientific research, as telescopes are to astrophysicists and microscopes are to chemists and biochemists, in that it provides a magnified type of window that allows us to look into subatomic particles, particles that make up the nucleus of atoms. We want to look into these because we want to determine what these particles are that make up the nucleus of an atom. What kind of characteristics do they have? Do they have a mass or don't they have a mass? Do they have a charge or don't they have a charge? If so, is it positive or is it negative, or perhaps they're neutral? And even more importantly, how do they act as building blocks for atomic structures themselves? And what is the mortar that holds these building blocks together? Because from one of these single bricks evolved many different types of structures, including ourselves and the chairs we're sitting on, the TV cameras that are looking at us, the moon, the earth, the sun, our solar system, our galaxy, the entire universe. So the implications for a fundamental physics project that essentially this particle beam accelerator is, that we call the superconducting supercollider, is one of astrophysical proportions, cosmological proportions, universal proportions, as well as the microcosmic proportions of the universe within the atom.
When we talk about subatomic particles, of course we're speaking of things that are almost infinitely small, but it might be helpful in terms of this discussion to put in perspective for our audience just how large this supercollider or superconducting supercollider is, the microscope that you're going to look at these things with.
Well, just as in astrophysics, the further you want to see out in the universe, the fringes of the universe, the bigger the telescope you need. Well, it's inversely true for that small universe, the microcosm of the universe, the world within the atom. You need a big microscope. So what we're proposing to do is to build this kind of microscope so that it produces the energies and mass necessary and required to break apart these little particles so we can peek inside to see what they're made of. To do that, we need a machine that's about 52 miles in circumference. That's pretty big, sort of like the beltway around Washington, D.C. You need that kind of machine in order to accelerate these particles at the speed of light so they won't go off course. If you try to put them in a smaller type circle when they're going that fast and, of course, want to go straight, just like your car wants to go straight at high speeds, and you have difficulty maneuvering around sharp corners at high speeds, well, the same is true with these particles. The higher the speed, the straighter they want to go. So you, with a 52-mile circumference ring, they don't have to turn any tight corners. And with guiding magnets that focus them and bend them around these corners and keep them very tightly confined, sort of like a little rocket the size of a piece of pencil lead, you can, in fact, get them up to the speed of light and continue having them orbiting in this collider ring, if you will, this 52 miles in circumference, without hitting the beam pipe in which they are inside a vacuum that's only about maybe 3 or 4 inches in diameter and never hitting the wall.
Sandy Emerson.
Rick, Idaho is well known over history for its nuclear research. Why would Idaho be a prime candidate for this, and then what benefits for the citizens of Idaho are there in this project?
Well, Idaho has many advantages. When you consider the history of the Idaho National Engineering Laboratory, which is the largest national engineering laboratory in the country, in size, it's about 890 square miles, all located in eastern Idaho, all on contiguous property of dedicated federal land. In addition to that, it has just under $3 billion worth of facilities in place, and about 10,000 scientists, engineers, technicians, craftspeople, administrative support people working on the site. That, in combination with the type of budget and the type of work that they've been doing over the past 40 years, it gives them a tremendous amount of technical expertise in construction of high-energy type facilities. Although they're not high-energy physics type facilities, they are, in fact, nuclear physics type facilities. So they have a fundamental type of knowledge and expertise in constructing and operating structures of this magnitude. But this, however, will be the first particle beam accelerator of its size any place in the world. The biggest one in the country now is the Tevatron that was just dedicated last October, 1985, as part of the Fermilab operation, which has been going on for 20 years now, outside of Chicago, Illinois, in Batavia. That's about 1/20th scale. So you can see that the difference is by a factor of 20 greater in order to see and open these last, what they say are the last doors on this frontier of particle physics. And Idaho has the facilities to do this. That's why we have a leg up.
Will this increase the educational requirements of the state and also the opportunity to other spin-off benefits to the state of Idaho and also North Idaho?
Yes, well, Idaho has some mixed advantages and disadvantages. And of course, the advantages are, as I just enumerated with the site we do have, and also the availability of low-cost power that's such a privilege here in the Northwest. However, the disadvantage is in the university system, the educational system in Idaho. And Idaho needs to do its homework. They need to inventory the shortcomings within our educational system. And I mean grades K through 12 as well as the universities, to determine ways that we can upgrade and improve and reinforce those areas of discipline that would be supportive to a project like this. It's going to take initially about 3,000 people to operate. In 10 years, that would double to about 6,000 people. A very small proportion of those would be high-energy physicists. Most of those people would be engineers and technicians and administrative support people and craftspeople. And although Idaho is a long way from ever being dominant in high-energy physics, we can certainly make up for that by being dominant in engineering and other areas of support, especially through our Voltech system, that would so strongly reinforce a project like this. Because to get the personnel to operate a project that's so unique, that's a one of its kind technological dream, you need to train those people. And the only place you train them is in the university system and the school system. And we have a short period of time, I say less than 10 years, to beef up that part of Idaho that's so essential to supporting a project of this kind.
So, Rick, you are saying that under the auspices of the Department of Energy nationally, that they will make the decision, and you're looking at the target 1990 for that decision, and then right after that, it would be shortly after that that the construction would take place, and following that extensive construction, then the educational system and everything else will have to be online in the early 1990s. Is that correct?
That's exactly correct. Essentially, the process that we're anticipating, because we're still waiting for authorization of this from Department of Energy, we're encouraged because Department of Energy has spent about $65 million to date, spent or committed, to research and development for the superconducting supercollider. So they are interested. Those are clear signals that they're interested. But they have yet to authorize a project, so it's still a technological dream. They are going to do a review this summer, probably when this program is aired. They may have a decision ready to be announced that they're authorizing the project and they're going to take it to Capitol Hill for funding. By this time next year, by the spring or summer of 87, if that took place, they would be issuing a request for proposal to the interested states and give the states about 90 days to respond. Then, through the with the help of selected panels from the National Academy of Sciences, National Academy of Engineers, and of course the High Energy Physics Advisory Panel and the Energy Research and Advisory Board would have an impact in the studies also, they would do a selection of a short list. From that short list of about four states, the Department of Energy, along with a congressional delegation, because it would be a political decision as well, as it should be, would make the final selection. And that, as you've already identified, would be about 1990. We hope to be that state. We think because of the science city we already have, on those $3 billion of facilities on the 890 square miles, that we have a leg up and we can offer an incredibly competitive cost and schedule program over any other state. I think we have all the other states cold when it comes to initial cost, how much it's going to cost to build that, as well as long-term cost, how much is it going to cost to operate that on a year-to-year basis. And the scheduling, insofar as the time it could be built, we could probably do it much more quickly than most other states because it's dedicated land. We don't have to do the permitting and the easements and rights away that you would have to do in an urban area.
I'd like to move into another area and I'll return to the panel. we just mentioned it very briefly at the beginning of the program, and I know that there are viewers out there that are just so eager to know if, when this gets in place and the research takes place, I'm sure you have contact with scientists. After all that research, what are some of the results that could come out of this? So what kind of breakthroughs are we talking about?
Well, the breakthroughs are actually difficult to predict because you're on the frontier of science. You're on the cutting edge. You're opening up doors, and you can predict what you're going to see based on history. But you can't say proof positive, this is what I'm going to find. If you could, it wouldn't be research. It'd be a historical undertaking. In the what they're doing with some particle beam accelerator centers now, such as at Fermilab, is pion cancer therapy, where they're able to eradicate cancer cells without doing any kind of surgery whatsoever through running an experiment off of the particle beam accelerator and using a pion to enter a body, knowing it's only going to live for a fraction of a second, and timing when it's going to go into a decay so that it flashes on that cell. So that essentially you have negligible damage, if any at all, at the surrounding tissue. And traditional surgery doesn't offer that. Open heart surgery might be a thing of the past because of the same type of mechanism where you can enter a vein, go through the left atrium, knock out plaque without damaging any tissue, without cutting anything, and go back out again. Nuclear magnetic resonance. They're producing, hospitals now have magnetic image makers where instead of doing exploratory surgery to find out what's wrong with you, they can essentially take a picture and see everything they need to know without ever picking up a scalpel. You've got super trains in Japan that are operating off of these superconducting magnets, magnets that are cooled down to almost 0 degrees Kelvin, close to 265 degrees below Fahrenheit. There's no resistance in the electrical field, so that means you could the energy going around there isn't being dissipated. It's almost a perpetual motion machine because unless you tap it off, it'll essentially flow forever with no resistance. That means for power transmission lines, you might not have any loss of electricity. To operate trains like the super train, the same type of thing. Very economical, very fast, very efficient, and effective.
It'll be one of the most exciting centers in the world, wherever this is, for the field of physics.
It certainly will. If you look on the history of what's happening at accelerator centers now, as soon as they build a new one to do a complementary type of research, because they always try to focus on doing research that's different than any of the other accelerator centers, so there's no duplication, no overlap. At CERN in Switzerland, there's 13 member states that have an organization to operate an accelerator center there. They have about 3,600 scientists from countries all over the world signing 5- and 10-year labor contracts just for the opportunity to work there. An accelerator of this size would be so far out on the cutting edge that scientists and the interest we're getting now from scientists internationally indicates that they would be clamoring for an opportunity to visit the site and to do experimental or theoretical work at the site or analytical work.
Steve Sheen.
We talked about some of the potential scientific benefits of this facility. What would the economic benefits be to the state of Idaho if it's successful in a bid to locate the superconducting supercollider here?
Well, I like to think of the economic benefits of going far beyond the state of Idaho, reaching into the Northwest, reaching into Canada, reaching into the entire country, ultimately the entire world. And I say that, and I don't mean to be superlative, but there's a possibility that we can get collaboration on the computer-type detectors from Japan, collaboration on construction from Canada, collaboration on the magnet manufacturing from Italy and perhaps Germany, and on and on and on. So the economic benefits, I would hope, would be international. This is a global project involving global research, scientists from all over the world working on pure science research for peaceful purposes. And I think that concept is fantastic. How it would benefit Idaho directly is, number one, you have a $4.5 billion project, just the building. For payroll on construction, you're looking at starting out, we'll say, 1991 with about 1,200 laborers. By 1993, that would peak to about 3,000 to 5,000 laborers. By 1996, construction would be complete, it would be operational, and you would have had a payroll of about $859 million for those tradespeople and craftspeople just to build it. Operationally, it would start off with about 3,000 scientists, engineers, technicians, craftspeople, administrative support, with a payroll of about $86 million a year. By the year 2007, that'd be doubled to over $160 million a year and about 6,000 people operating the site. So what you're looking at from construction within Idaho, from construction through about 25 years of operation, is almost $4.5 billion for payroll alone.
Are there any
negatives? So you're talking state revenues of from construction through 25 years of operation of pushing $400 million.
Any negatives at all associated with a project like this?
With this kind of project being built in a remote area of dedicated federal land, I can really think of no negative whatsoever, other than the fact that Idaho has to shore up its educational facilities.
Sandy Emerson.
We're working very hard as a community, and actually the whole Inland Empire, in tapping into the major government procurement programs, and of course small business is targeted for a share of this. The current leadership at INEL is involved with that. How can local businesses become more involved with that in Idaho, particularly the Inland Empire?
Well, I think that there's at least a threefold responsibility there. Ultimately, the responsibility rests on local businesses of taking the initiative of getting involved with a project such as this, or any other type of project, be it high tech or timber or mining or tourism or whatever, that they feel they have services to offer or a product to offer. It's government's responsibility, and the chambers of commerce and key citizen groups, Rotary clubs, Kiwanis clubs, whatever, to try to ferret out some of this information and form umbrella type or identify umbrella type of organizations such as your Chamber of Commerce that could then disseminate this information within your five county jurisdiction to say, hey, I know that they're doing sub-assembly work on the detectors, and I know that you're involved in sub-assembly on detectors. What do you say we get together and go down there and see if we can get a piece of this work? And those are the kinds of efforts it's going to take, because it's going to be difficult with the complexity and size of this project to have people do the bird dogging themselves, trying to find private enterprise that could take advantage. We're trying to do whatever we can to drive out the technology, forming exclusive licensing type of franchises and what are other kinds of mechanisms and vehicles we can do to get the manufacturing into the hands of local industry and get the labor support into the hands of local industry. But we also need help in the local industry to come out from their community and let us know what they're doing and what they're interested in. And then the merge will work.
Rick, I know that since you have this title, that you're coordinating this whole process. And can you give us any insight? And we take the show in April, and I know things will happen before it airs, since we don't tape in the summertime, and we have to run shows then. What kind of responsibility do you have of putting this together? I know you are in the Department of Commerce, and you work with the governor's office, and which it is an arm of the governor's office, and you work with the congressional delegation, the Idaho legislature, and the business community. I just know this is a mammoth undertaking. Give us some kind of idea of the sketch of how you're trying to put this together.
Well, it is a mammoth undertaking, but by the same token, I look at this as more of an adventure than a job, because it's a fascinating project, and it does give me an opportunity to work on a lot of different fronts at once, both within this state, within other states that are also competing for the project, and on the congressional delegation level in Washington, D.C., as well as our legislative level here in Idaho, and keeping up on the international level of what they're doing with their accelerator projects. And that's part of the job, is seeing where everybody else is in their status and initiatives towards promoting the construction of the superconducting supercollider. The other responsibility would be in coordinating the writing of a proposal to the Department of Energy to answer all the questions that the high energy physics people would want answered before they could make a decision on where they're going to site it.
So you have a tremendous number of consultants, don't you, that are experts in the field? And
well, I could buy with a little help from my friends, as I told you earlier. So far, most of the consulting has been done on a voluntary basis. And we've needed a lot geoscience-wise, construction costs estimating, community and urban setting criteria, infrastructure criteria. Even my income at this point and my travel expenses and administrative expenses are all through the generous contributions of private businesses within Idaho. We would hope that the state government would make an appropriation to help our battle, because I think they also have a need to invest in this program, as private industry has. The universities are volunteering to quite an extent to also help with the marketing aspect of this and the budgetary aspects of what the universities need to do.
I'm going to have to interrupt. The clock has caught up with us, but I can say on behalf of the panel, I'm sure that this has been extremely informative, and we wish you good luck on our behalf as you undertake this project. Ladies and gentlemen, I hope you've enjoyed our program, and it certainly has a great magnitude for the future of this area if it is successful. We've talked with Rick Trembley, who is the coordinator of the superconducting supercollider proposal that's before the national government. I hope you've enjoyed this program, and I want to invite you to be with us again next week at this same time when we'll discuss an important subject. Until then, please have a good week. I am Tony Stewart.
North Idaho College Public Forum can be seen at this same time each week over this station. This production was videotaped earlier by a North Idaho College student crew for viewing at this more appropriate time.